When it becomes easier to kill people is when the propaganda does not work anymore.
That's right.
And you cannot control the people anymore. So they still try to work these different methods to control the people, and they want you to cancel out the people who may be your liberators.
Yes, sir.
Why would you want to cancel Kanye when in him is the brilliance of God that has the ability to write and produce music that can actually transform the thinking of the people?
Yes, sir.
He got an album out called Jesus is King.
Yes, sir.
What Jesus you think he talking about?
Come on now. Come on.
He ain't talking about the one 2,000 years ago.
That's right.
There's a Jesus in our midst today.
Mm-hmm.
He called Farrakhan Sensei.
Yes, sir.
You think that's dangerous with a man with the kind of influence that Kanye has?
Yes, sir.
But we're so easy to cancel him out off a few actions. Now, when the last time you've been perfect?
Come on, sir. Come on, brother.
Where did we get this? Where we so easy to point somebody else's mess out?
Come on. Mm-hmm.
Were you so easy to cancel somebody? When the last time you've been canceled?
Go ahead now.
Come on,
now.
Come on, sir.
Yes.
We so easy to cancel someone, but then act like hypocrites.
Come on. Yes, sir.
Because we want to call somebody else stuff out.
That's what we do.
Get in our little cubby holes and talk about people.
Yes, sir.
Right, brother. Hey,
nigga ain't special.
Yes, sir.
Nigga think he is. Mm-hmm. Who you think you are?
Come on,
right.
Sir.
I don't love my enemy. Well, that's what Jesus said. If you shut up again, God don't love his enemies. So you stop it. You sound sick. The enemy killed your brother, and I'm a policeman, and I don't know what was wrong with me. I went to the wrong apartment, and this black man was sitting in my apartment, and I pulled out my gun and I shot him 3 or 4 times. You did? You did. And you only got 10 years? And then one of the brothers was mourning the loss of his brother. Can I have a hug? Can I hug you? When is the last time you said that to your husband that you fell out with? See, just look at yourself. You are so easy to hate your own. So slow to forgive, but you can forgive an enemy that's been your enemy ever since you've been here.
Negro gatherings and sucking up the white people. Everybody need to vote. Everybody need to vote. Everybody need to vote. You need to vote on separation. That's what we need to vote on. Do you want to go or do you want to stay? We need programs. A public school that can teach us. They gave you that. That's why you're so ignorant. You're a manifestation of what they've given us. Okay? Stop this. True freedom. And I'm coming down to the end. I want to say this too from the Muslim program. I want to read and read. We need to reread. Number 4, what the Muslims want. Number 1, we want freedom. We want a full and complete freedom. Didn't get it, ain't gonna get it. Number two, we want justice, equal justice under the law. We want justice applied equally to all, regardless of creed or class or color. We're not racist. Justice, didn't get it, ain't gonna get it. Not after 450 years. We want equality of opportunity. We want equal membership in society with the best in civilized society. Didn't get it, not gonna get it. So here we are at number four. We want our people in America whose parents or grandparents were descendants from slaves. He didn't say Muslims. He didn't say Christians. He didn't say agnostic, nationalist, bewildered. He said, if your parents or grandparents were descendants from slaves, that's all of us, okay? We want to be allowed to establish, that's the word I want to look at, establish a separate state or territory. Because people among us, scared people, always raise, well, how are we going to govern ourselves? What is, how, there's going to be problems. What are we doing right now? What is happening to us right now? Oh, they're going to kill us. Gonna? That started in 1555. Are you serious? Established, that means when we get there, we will set up a government. We don't have to have all of our I's dotted and T's crossed to leave. Nobody else that ever did it like that. And yes, there were others that did it. Starting with the United States of America. What do we want? Listen, we need, this is what black people and our youth need, and it angers me how we talk to our young people, how we treat our young people, how we use slave-based negative reinforcement. Don't get pregnant. Don't get on drugs. Don't go to jail. Don't drop out of school. I grew up in a black community, what they would call middle class, set up in the 1950s by the brothers returning from World War II, the Tuskegee Airmen. My father, you know, teacher, who's a teacher, you know, doctors, lawyers, dentists, landscapers, day laborers. If you were black, you were together. My teachers were black. My dentist was black. The mail carrier was black. Okay? Everybody was black. So I'm like, yeah, you know, I didn't even know there was racism, as Allah is my witness. I didn't know until about the fifth grade. This is the truth. I vaguely knew about white people because we saw them here and there down. I didn't know the battles my parents and our parents were fighting behind the scenes and the cocoon that me and my peers were being kept in and protected from, you see? But I know that life, and that's why I'm fighting to get it back, because integration destroyed that. There were communities like that all over America. And even when we didn't have as much in certain areas, you know, the black man went out and was making things happen, okay? The black woman was building a home and a life. We knew how to sew. We knew how to make, my mother made coats. Okay? And it was, when you can sew, you can go out and get real linen and silk and things of this nature, we're buying clothes in Walgreens. Because all we're wearing is underwear. We're not even wearing clothes outside anymore. We're going outside in underwear. I saw my daughter sashaying out the door. Excuse me. Can you drop me? I can't drop you. I can't pick you up. Where are your clothes? Well, these are Jenkins. Well, I know you just tell your friends, your mother's old, your parents, just tell them, you know my parents are in the nation. You know my mother, I mean, they just, you know, they think like they think. Ma, I'm a Muslim too. No, ma'am, you're not going out with that. When I was coming up, those were called tights, stockings, underwear. I go out and I see our women. We called that a camisole. That's what you wore under your blouse. And it's not only the lack of modesty, it's the optics. How do you get up in age? You're somebody's grandmother. And yeah, it's almost like, oh. I mean, if I didn't have a religion, I would still be looking away. It's not attractive. I don't know how I got on that. Oh, integration. Integration. Copy in this nasty white woman. That's what I was trying to say. She loves being naked. That's what it was. But true freedom is the power to make choices. And our youth aren't being given the power to make choices because they're not being given options. You know, if you didn't get picked in the NBA draft, if somebody didn't take your record, if you're not selling drugs, then what are you gonna do? You see? And we enable the devil's system. Because we tell them, you can do this, this, or this. In order to properly educate and rear children, you have to have some of the traits of a prophet. You have to be in obedience to God so that God will develop the gift of prophecy in you. Why do you have to be a prophet to rear children? Because you're preparing them for a world that has yet to come into existence. Why are you telling them, go get a job at the post office? Who says the post office is going to be here? It's going down now. The man that developed FedEx was in freshman year or sophomore year of college in business. And the professor told them to develop a business plan. He comes back with an idea for delivering mail overnight. They gave him an F. The man said, you know, 3 days, 5 days, nobody need no mail the next day. They're not gonna pay no extra money. The mail is fast enough. Developed Starbucks coffee. He had visited Europe and saw how they put so much value on fresh coffee from the best coffee beans, ground right there in your presence. In America, they're drinking coffee out of gas stations that's been sitting on a hot plate for 9 hours, knock you out with the smell. So a man said, I'm gonna open up some gourmet coffee shops. And they said, ain't nobody, coffee's 20 cents a cup. Cause he said, mine's gonna be about $2-3. What? Yeah, the other day I just paid $7 for a grande mocha in the airport. You know, they hold you cap, you're a hostage in the airport. $7, I said, excuse me? Where were you gonna go? She didn't say that, but she looked. I said, okay, okay. Well, look at what happened. There are people that will pay to have their coffee customized who will pay for that experience. All right. My point being, if you don't have vision, you can't rear children. Because you're going to confine them to the present. The Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan said our children, and I'm done, were born to solve the problems of their time. So they are more intelligent than us. Our value is we know more than them because we've been here. See, I can tell my daughters, because I've been 22. It's starting to fade. It's so long ago. But where you are, I've been there, so I can help you maneuver. But your intelligence level, that's why on the phones and the on my iPads, I'm sitting there, I don't know how to get this to send this. And my daughter, oh, God. And I'm like, yeah, she did it. How did she do it? My three-year-old grandson called my daughter last night. She called, see, Amira called me. He said, how you doing, auntie? What you doing? And his mother's like, oh, I think he must have accidentally. My daughter said,
if the youngest of four made a phone call, it would look a lot like Google Fox.
He called me. He can read my name. He took a selfie when he was 4 months old. He did. I'm not saying that as, you know, he did. He did. This is who we are confronted with. So we have the duty. The minister said it may take us 50 years to complete. Didn't he say it last night, beloved? To complete it, but we're required to move out on it. Let's get it going, all right? President Abraham Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation, and I close on this, because I want us to come out of this idea that separation is some aberration that is crazy or irrational. And I just, I this is where I live. I can't do this. When Lincoln emancipated us, January 1st, 1863, that was an act of within a war. What he was doing was weakening the South by taking away its slaves. It wasn't some epiphany he had. They're human. No. He was weakening the rebellion. That proclamation had zero impact on the state of Texas. It was only after Robert E. Lee surrendered in April of 1865 and Union forces showed up in Galveston, Texas, June 19th, 1865, was federal authority enforced. That's Juneteenth. According to historical accounts, beloved, upon hearing that profound and shocking news that they had been released, many of our ancestors walked off the plantation immediately. Many stayed, but we don't see that in the movies and the film. Many left, though they had nowhere to go. The number one goal for most of the newly emancipated black people was to find family members. They immediately separated themselves from their slaveholder. Many left Texas and went to Louisiana, Arkansas, and Oklahoma searching for loved ones. So celebrating June 19, 1865 served at that time and serves now as relief. It's relief for a moment from the extreme pressure, as I open with pressure, of seeking freedom, justice, and equality in a country that refuses to confer full citizenship on its former slaves. So Juneteenth was and remains a time for a shattered black community to get a little bit of restoration and repair. Pray, break bread together, enjoy recreational activities. Now, 89 years before Juneteenth, the all-white, all-male, mostly slave-holding members of the Continental Congress, right here in Philadelphia, approved by a vote of 12 of the 13 North American British colonies. That's what it was called. Now, we're slaves. They've been holding us since 1555. They didn't become a nation until 1776. It was us that took them to a point where they could even function as a nation. 12 of the 13 North American British colonies voted to officially separate from Great Britain. New York abstained. I don't know what that was about. Like, I think you said it, Brother Rodney, brother, on Friday night, there ain't nothing new about New York or New Jersey. Okay. But the document that they approved of was written almost entirely by Thomas Jefferson, and it was and is known as the Declaration of Independence. The Declaration of Independence explains the Constitution. That declaration is saying, this is why we're breaking from you, okay? It was voted July 2nd and adopted July 4th, 1776. So the biggest national holiday in this country celebrates separation. Now let's come quickly to present time so we can go home. Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell from the slave-holding state of Kentucky observed with them little eyes rolling around and his got these little black eyes that look like a shark. No expression. Because they're made. They're not created people. They're made people. But as they just roll around, you got a shark looks at its target and will just eat anything that will go in its mouth. That's them. They will eat anything that will fit in their mouths. They've taken over this whole globe. But he said, well, I don't think it's a good idea to have reparations paid because, number one, it happened. Something happened 150 years ago when none of us were living, like it was a car accident, a single event. Something happened 150 years ago. None of us were living. Then he comes back and says, to expound on it, we gave you civil rights laws. Wait a minute, here's the coup de grace. We let you have a black president. We elected, did he say it? We elected a black president. First of all, hypocrite, you were vehemently opposed to Barack Obama being president to the point where you were not at the inauguration. You were down the street with your cohorts in a meeting committing to destroy his presidency, and you spent 8 years trying to take him down. You lying, hypocrite devil. Not that having a black president of white America has anything to do with repairing us. Those statements, though, I'm only bringing them because what he said is the mindset of white America. I've heard them make statements like, you have Oprah. You have Michael Jordan. I mean, you have wealthy blacks. We have to ask ourselves, do we want to be around people with such a damaged perception of reality? Or should we consider separation? Should we demand, along with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, should we demand the allocation of land right here in North America, in the country we made powerful and wealthy? Those 13 colonies, beloved, did not melt into some single entity. Each one of those 13 colonies, and ultimately 37 more, 35 more on the continent, and two additional ones not on the continent, Alaska, and then one way out in the Pacific Ocean, Hawaii, all became free, independent states. See, what is the Honorable Elijah Muhammad saying? He said, establish a separate state or territory. I'm showing you, this is how America is constructed. We're not crazy. It's already built to accommodate what we're talking about. 50 states bound together in a political union called the United States of America. Each state holds governmental jurisdiction over a separate and defined geographic territory and shares its sovereignty with the federal government. Americans who are citizens, meaning white people, are citizens of the Federal Republic and citizens of the state where they reside. No federal approval, no state approval is required for us to move between the states. Everyone is free to go. You can say, I'm moving to Atlanta. You ever think about that? That you could just wake up and say, I'm going to move to Atlanta? In Europe, if you left Pennsylvania and going to New Jersey, you had to go through customs with a passport. Four of these states use the term Commonwealth because that's how they want to be known. No two states of the 50 are identical in how they function. Every one of them has their own flag. Every one of them has their own, I should have brought it, constitution. Everyone has their own government. They have executive, legislative, judicial branch, but guess what? They don't have to. There's no law that requires it. The 10th Amendment to the Constitution said the state has any power that the federal government doesn't already have. They each have, each state controls the education in it. Each state has a National Guard and a military defense and police. Each state has public goods and services, electricity and gas and water. That's not federal. Each state does that. Social welfare programs. And each state, the federal government only exists as a political union of all these. Who's in Congress? Where did they come from? From the states. Who decides who's a congressmen in the House of Representatives, the state. Who decided Mitch McConnell should be a senator? Not the feds. Them devils in the state of Kentucky sent him to say what he's saying. So why shouldn't we? The 40 to million, 60 million descendants of slaves consider a state or states right here. We don't even all have to live there. But we need some space that we control. And I'm going to tell you, even if you live somewhere else, you would be better off if you have a place that you can call yours so that you have that backup. And I'm going to say this leaving the rostrum. We're not going to get reparations until we do this or put this in motion. I'm going to tell you why. Because right now, we're just a bunch of black people like Tweety Bird. So the white man gets to put a mic in Al Sharpton's face or Cory Booker's face. And I don't know what's wrong with him, Brother Rodney. I don't know what happened to him. He's talking about we need to dream again. I don't know who's writing his. I was like, oh my God, sit down, please. We need to go back to Dr. King. I'm not going back nowhere. I don't even want to be where we are now. Let alone, as they say, go back. But the point being, beloved, why shouldn't we at least consider a separate state or group of states or territory of our own? The Mormons did it. The senators from Utah are Mormons. The Congress people from Utah are Mormons. Now they've gotten up in the state of Maine. Brother Rodney, and because I think, and then Mitt Romney in Michigan, that their family is Mormon. So the point is, you can still move in and out of states. And the minister told them, we have to have some of those states have to be border states so that we can get in and out. He mentioned Alabama last night. We were talking about Alabama the other day. He mentioned it again last night. We're not going to be landlocked where we can't get out of, in and out of here. But you know what he told them in one of his lectures? He said, you know, white America, it would be a blessing to you to have us on some borders, because ain't nobody getting past us. Trust and believe. If the Muslims, anywhere we are, it's always going to be peace and good behavior. I really wish Dylann Roof had come to our study group. Okay. May Allah bless us all with love and the light of understanding. As-salamu alaykum.
Put your hands together. National spokesperson for the Honorable Louis Farrakhan and the Nation of Islam. A student in the ministry of the Honorable Louis Farrakhan, Minister Ava Muhammad. All praises due to Allah. All praises due to Allah. I know some of us are for our first time, some are for our second and all of that. And so what I'm going to ask you all to do now is to come on down the aisle. I want you to shake the hand of this woman, this black woman that taught us today. Come on, let's come on out the aisle, male and female. Come on around. We're going to take the sisters first. Line the brothers up over there. Come on down. Come on down. All praises due to Allah. All right, all right. They're coming down, they're coming down. Let our sisters come on down. Pam Africa is with us today. Yes, yes. Yeah. All right, all right. Come on down, come on down. The sisters are coming on down. See, this is what's going to bring black folks back together. We got to break up with them in order to get hooked up again.
Life is about climbing. It's about the steps you take. Social media got everybody wanting to skip the steps of success. And that's the issue. We fall in love with people's results instead of the process. When I look at people's content and I look at where people are and I'm measuring their success, I'm thinking about all the work that went in order to get to where they are, all the knowledge they had to attain in order to achieve the goals that they wanted to do, all of the conversations that they had to build the network that they currently have, the integrity that they have to build honest relationships, to cultivate these things, the dire amount of sheer hours that they had to dedicate and focus, meaning that they couldn't spend time on escapism and liabilities because they had to dedicate their focus to things that they actually wanted to build. If you skip the steps in life, you will never truly get to the top because you will never know what it takes in order to achieve there. You will never have that enduring strength. You have to learn to love the steps. I want you to think of what step in life that you are right now. And I want you to fall in love with it. I want you to be patient. Because the beautiful thing about life is the journey. The only destination in life is the death. So enjoy life. Take your time. Take it step by step. That's how you get to the bigger picture. It's a huge mountain to climb. But if somebody just transported you to the top, that would not make you a climber of the mountain. That would just be somebody that's there at the top that wouldn't have the ability or perseverance to even go back down. And you definitely couldn't come back up if you ever fail. So don't skip the steps. That's how you achieve that mountain of success, plant your flag, and be able to teach others how to do it. Fall in love with the journey, not the results.
Separation of schools. If we ever expect to rear our children up in a decent life and God-fearing children and clean-minded children, we had better put them in a school to themselves or teach them our own self, because the public schools of the enemy destroys them. The moral of a black children's, regardless to what school you enter in with them. Your child is gone. The way of hell. I thank you. As-salamu alaykum.
For more information on the life-giving teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, you may contact us on the World Wide Web at www.mems.com. That's www.mems.com. Or you may call for a free catalog at area code 770-907-2212. Thank you very much for your support, and may the peace and blessings of Allah, who came in the person of Master Farad Muhammad, be with you in the name of his last and greatest messenger, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. As-salamu alaykum.
becomes easier to kill people is when the propaganda does not work anymore.
That's right.
And you cannot control the people anymore. So they still try to work these different methods to control the people, and they want you to cancel out the people who may be your liberators.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Why would you want to cancel Kanye when in him is the brilliance of God that has the ability to write and produce music that can actually transform the thinking of the people?
Yes, sir.
He got an album out called Jesus is King.
Yes, sir.
What Jesus you think he talking about?
Come on now. Come on.
He ain't talking about the one 2,000 years ago.
That's right.
There's a Jesus in our midst today.
Mm-hmm.
He called Farrakhan Sensei.
Yes, sir.
You think that's dangerous with a man with the kind of influence that Kanye has?
Yes, sir.
But we're so easy to cancel him out off a few actions. Now, when the last time you've been perfect?
Come on, sir. Come on, brother.
Where did we get this? Where we so easy to point somebody else's mess out?
Come on.
Mm-hmm. Were you so easy to cancel somebody? When the last time you've been canceled?
Go ahead now.
Come on,
now.
Come on, sir.
Yes.
We so easy to cancel someone, but then act like hypocrites.
Come on. Yes, sir.
Because we want to call somebody else stuff out.
That's what we do.
Get in our little cubby holes and talk about people.
Yes, sir.
Right, go ahead, brother.
Hey, nigga ain't special.
Yes, sir.
Nigga think he is.
Who you think you are?
Come on,
right.
Sir.
Jesus said, if you shut up again. God don't love his enemies. So you stop it. You sound sick. The enemy kill your brother. And I'm a policeman and I don't know what was wrong with me. I went to the wrong apartment, and this black man was sitting in my apartment, and I pulled out my gun and I shot him 3 or 4 times. You did? You did. And you only got 10 years? And one of the brothers who's mourning the loss of his brother.
So I said, we have a plan, we play them mentally. If we think about it, all it takes is a thought. We make sense of our decisions, and it's gonna happen regardless. I own 2 businesses in Detroit, and I'm not giving them up no time soon. So if they come to the city, now they support 2 of my businesses. It's up to us to buy things.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said to us, that everything that exists in the universe comes from a thought. He said thought travels on the average of 24 billion miles per second. Some faster and some thoughts are slower. What determines the speed of a man's thought? It is the sincerity of that thought and the amount of bridges inside of the brain that transmit the said thought. So the more bridges we have from cell to cell, and the more sincere our thoughts are, the faster they are able to move and accomplish that which we think. So when the white man studied the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he said, okay, let's destroy the black man's mind. So I will design drugs that are built to break bridges between each brain cell. And since that thought, 24 billion miles per second, needs the 14 billion brain cells in order to land and to transmit its energy, I will work to destroy the bridges between each cell and ultimately get rid of the cells altogether. That way, no matter how fast the thought is traveling, no matter how sincere the original man's thought might be, if they have no bridges, then they will not be able to bring in existence what they think in a satisfactory time period. And they will develop frustration, disappointment, disbelief in themselves, and turn on one another. So the white man made crack cocaine. I said the white man made crack cocaine.
Shaolin shadow boxing and the Wu-Tang saw style. If what you say is true, the Shaolin and the Wu-Tang could be dangerous. Do you think your Wu-Tang sword can defeat me?
On guard. I'll let you try my Wu-Tang style.
I thought about how I arranged all of this. I was here, a lieutenant here in Chicago. And I love Chicago. I was out of Elijah Muhammad's security man. I went everywhere he went. California, my first jet flight was with him, going to Los Angeles, 1960. And one day he came out to the mosque one night and spoke. He said, I got good labors here. He said, but I need your help. I want y'all to go out and help me. At that moment, boom, you got to leave Chicago. So I had never had no intentions of leaving Chicago. But the brothers from LA, when I got registered at, they came through here, saved me in 61. Promise me this and promise me that. Come on out. Blah, blah, blah. So, I believe I'm going back out there. But when I got to Miami, I saw the, I might say it like a little raggedy place we were living in. And it had a hole over the back of the glove when we were speaking. And he didn't have enough knowledge at that time to put a curtain over the wall. So I sat there, and I said, if I left this hall, I was going to kill me. Then the hundred thousand miles I was down there, and he told the minister to make him your captain. So that's how I became a captain through his orders. So now one day, and I have a few brothers, so I'm in the captain, but I ain't got no army. So now I got to make my own army. So I hit the streets. And some selling papers. So I was on the streets of Miami, 6th Street, 2nd Avenue. By the middle of the hotel, a black hotel. And he saw me.
Hey, brother!
Why we call Negroes? Why everybody making progress? And we lagging so far behind. This was a song. That the honorable minister Louis Farrakhan put out.
Called White Man Heaven.
Black Man Hell.
He said, man, you're the champion of the world. So, you want to check my book out? Come to my room. Show me a clipping where he had shipped up Ingram, who was the heavyweight champion at that time.
He was in Miami for a rematch with Floyd Patterson, who he had taken the title from. But Ali beat him up.
In a spine session.
So they said, he's a brash kid from Louisville. He's about to mess up a $4 million date. And when I looked up at him, seen him doing his thing.
I said, if I look out for this boy,
he would be champ.
So from that day on, I was teaching them Islam.
teaching him Islam.
And he was living in a rooming house, I should say.
They had him there.
And he was making money.
For white folks.
I said, man, they got you here like this.
I said, man, you get you a hotel room in the Carver Hotel.
So they got him in the Carver Hotel.
You know where he could eat, the dining room, which was a leading black hotel in Miami.
And after that, he went out to the West Coast, beat Archimoe.
And when he got back to Archimoe, I said, make him get you a house.
These are big white men that owned them at that time.
I said, make him get you a house.
And when they got him, he got everything they gave it to him.
But see, he didn't know how to live.
So I'm telling him, teaching him the ropes, telling him how to go.
So they got in the house.
I put two Muslim sisters in there to make that soup every day.
I put another one in there to keep the house clean.
So now I got three Muslims on payroll.
Now I ain't talking about donations.
Payroll.
The white folks are paying for. Okay, so that went on. Now, leading right up to the time he's getting ready to fight this.
Malcolm had made a statement in New York.
About the chickens coming home to roost.
Well, the honorable Elijah Muhammad took him out of speaking engagement.
For 90 days. Didn't take his ministry from him.
Just took him off the scene for 90 days.
So at that time, me and Ali, and Osman Kareem.
We said, let's send for Malcolm to come down here and cool out, like a little vacation.
So Malcolm came down, and after he got down, he asked me.
You know, the sister was cooking for me, everything.
So he asked me, if I go over to the gym,
will I hurt Brother Cassius?
I said, heck yeah, man, everybody know you.
Because in those days, we didn't expose Ali to the public that he was practicing Islam.
So he didn't want nobody to know it either.
So when Malcolm told him that,
he didn't listen to me.
He went in a way.
When I got in with Ali,
he was taking pictures.
So the news come out.
Boom.
Malcolm X is in Miami, recruiting Cassius Clay to Islam.
And I had the man in Islam over two or three years before Malcolm ever met the man.
Assalamu alaikum. In the most holy name of Allah, the all-wise, true, and living God, to whom all praise is due forever, for his coming and finding of the lost and found people of his father's house, the nation of Islam and tribe of Shabazz, Master Farrar Muhammad, the great Mahdi. We forever thank him for searching among us and finding one in whom he could put his spirit, his guidance, and leave us with a leader and a teacher, and now exalted Christ, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And we forever thank the Honorable Elijah Muhammad for praying that one would be in the classroom of God, that he could choose to put over the nation in his absence, the Most Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. I greet you who are listening to this presentation this afternoon with the greetings of peace and paradise. Assalamu alaikum. Briefly, brothers and sisters, I want you to know that I am truly honored and thankful to Almighty God Allah to be able to make this special presentation at Mosque Maryam. The body of knowledge contained in the Supreme Wisdom lessons given to us to study by Master Farrad Muhammad through his chosen servant, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, introduces us to an entire new school of thought, which is the foundation of a whole new world. The Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan called for the Atonement Commission to be comprised of 9 commissions in the late fall of the year 2000 to begin the process of the restructuring and reorganizing of the Nation of Islam. This assignment cannot be fully accomplished until we examine ourselves in the process by restructuring and reorganizing our thinking and our mind to be in accord with the thinking and the mind of God, who came in the person of Master Farrad Muhammad and his Christ, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. When the Honorable Minister Farrakhan stated that the 10th system to the commission represents the brain, I began to process this information by putting it into writing the following documents prepared as a student of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad to be considered as a contribution to this commission. My approach to this subject is directly linked to our lesson assignment and is based upon the mathematical definition of what Islam is. Following Minister Farrakhan's review of my materials submitted, he felt that I should come before the body and make a presentation to the commission and to the Nation of Islam based on my research and findings. I wish to thank the Honorable Minister for this opportunity, and I truly wish to acknowledge the help of those persons in the 7th region who assisted me in the preparation of my materials, which includes Sister Rosalind Mohammed for her computer and typing skills, to Sister Shernet Mohammed for her artistic skills in rendering illustrations and diagrams, and to my son Rasul Mohammed, who facilitated their participation as the helper of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan in the 7th region. Because it is very important, my dear beloved brothers and sisters, to give you the context out of which my inspiration came to present to the minister my paper, I want to share with you a letter and a 6-page dissertation that I was inspired to bring to him here in Chicago. On August 21 of this year, I wrote the following letter to the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, to the members of the 9 commissions, and the general body of students of the Nation of Islam. Assalamu alaikum. As a student and follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I submit the following material to be studied as an introduction to what I have discovered concerning the Supreme Wisdom lessons during the last 28 years since the departure of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. The fullness of what I have to report will be presented, be it the will of Allah, as my thesis on the mathematical theology of Islam to the University of Islam, as both an oral and written dissertation based on the lessons and the supreme wisdom teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Prior to the departure of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad in 1975, he sat with some of his laborers, officials, and family members and set the standard of our lessons as the basis of our work today. He requested of us to only ask questions pertaining to our lessons. He further stated that we would be examined before our Savior Allah on this assignment. In retrospect, tracing back to our early beginnings in the 1930s, his words came to us as the second reminder of the importance of studying this body of knowledge coming directly from Master W. Farrar Muhammad upon his departure in 1934. In May of this year, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan addressed our nation in a three-day webcast from Mosque Maryam, directing us to the same instructions given by his teacher, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, prior to his departure. He gently warned us to return back to our study of our original assignment, focusing on those early instructions to the laborers, which includes the lessons, the Holy Quran, and the Bible. As you may know, I have devoted a great deal of my studies to this assignment over the years and have made many interesting discoveries that link us to a more comprehensive understanding of both the Holy Quran and Bible from a more scientific and historical perspective. It has opened big fields of knowledge that engage truth on every new frontier of investigation and research. The great body of knowledge of the supreme wisdom is exactly that, and can be proven in no limit of time, which takes us into infinity. This is why we say mathematics is Islam and Islam is mathematics. While in Mexico, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad in 1974 instructed me further concerning the study of our lessons when he stated that the lessons would be the foundation of the teaching to the people of Mexico. This indicated to me that our lessons are indeed universal in nature, and we must study how to apply them at all times as the basis of our work today. He also asked me to inquire into the government qualifications for setting up a school in that country. Within a year, he was no longer among us. And ever since that time, I have been searching for a way to implement this assignment. I returned to the United States and formulated the Honorable Elijah Muhammad Educational Foundation in the late 1970s to continue in the study and research of his divine teachings and program and its application to a modern and scientific age. I am most thankful to Almighty God Allah for this opportunity to share with you some of my findings as we seek to improve the quality of our lives in the pursuit of happiness. Assalamu alaikum, most humbly submitted, Mother Taneta Muhammad. Now, brothers and sisters, I wanted to give to you the details and exactitude of the words as I presented them to the Honorable Minister Farrakhan on the very day that the commission met on August the 23rd here in Mosque Maryam. And I entitled my paper as only an introduction, How the 10th System, the Brain, is Applied to the Nine Commissions in the Restructuring and Reorganization of the Nation of Islam. This paper will be read to you at this time because I do not want to miss one connecting line or one connecting link which may not be received in the fullness of the meaning. I will attempt to equate the 10th system, the brain, to the reorganization and restructuring of the Nation of Islam, precisely to the lessons of the Supreme Wisdom. This body of knowledge, called the Supreme Wisdom, comes directly from God Himself in person. Each new convert that enters the Nation of Islam as a student must recite the 10 questions and answers of student enrollment before he or she is admitted into the classroom of God. And that is to be qualified for future positions awaiting them upon examination of their courses of study based on the lessons. It is this standard that is used to evaluate each student's progress to see if they are qualified to be fit for future placement by Almighty God Allah. You will find corresponding instructions in the 13 paragraphs to the laborers. Paragraph 1 explains that through Allah's prophets and apostles as the people's guide and example, that His mystery is revealed. And those who follow the apostle would see the light. In a dream I had many years ago, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan was leading me through a tunnel or passage that led to a door which was standing open. Inside there was a large gathering of people. He beckoned me to enter, and I simultaneously beckoned to him to enter. Once inside the room, I saw a large body of people seated like students in a classroom or a lecture hall. I looked for a chair, which was pointed out to me. Once seated, I looked up, and to my surprise, I saw Master Farrar Muhammad standing in the center of the room at a blackboard. He was writing the number 144,000. At the top of the circular-shaped room, there appeared, as if suspended from the ceiling, a giant crystal chandelier. The complete number of questions and answers and actual facts in our lessons comes to 154. When the 10 questions and answers of student enrollment are subtracted from the 154, we have 144 remaining questions and answers. The number 144,000 appears in the Bible as the first fruit converts to God and His Christ. This is a figure representing God's elect that will be taken out of the whole body of new converts that God would work with to first square and then cube the nations of the world into a standard of righteousness. 144 cubed equals 1,728 cubic inches, which is equal to 1 cubic foot. In time measurement, that is by days, 24 hours in a day multiplied by 6 days equals 144. The seventh day in creation is called the day of rest and is sanctified as the Lord's day. The seventh day is equal to the early morning of the 7,000th millennium in which Christ will establish His kingdom on earth. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad stated that the whole scope of Master Farrar Muhammad's teachings is astronomy. The inner meaning of the first 10 questions and answers of student enrollment is designated as the Big Ten, representing the family of the sun and her 9 planets. In its deeper meaning, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad compared the family of the Big Ten to the role of the woman who carries the life germ in her womb for 9 months to completion and birth. To study astronomy, we must have a knowledge of mathematics, the universal language to acquire universal knowledge. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad has stated that a people who do not have a knowledge of mathematics cannot build and will always be subject to a people who know mathematics. I once asked the Honorable Elijah Muhammad if Master W. Farrar Muhammad continues to study, and he answered me in the affirmative. So what excuse do we have not to study? According to the history of Jesus and His mother, also given to us to study by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad as a sign of our evolving and developing community, we read that mathematics was the number one subject that the prophet or the wise man required of Jesus to begin teaching him how to tune in. This knowledge was given to him to protect him in his mission against the plot of the enemies who sought to take his life. Mary and Joseph also had the ability to tune in. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad told us that 1 in every 100 of our people in the East also have this ability. The prophet began teaching Jesus, and because he was quick in learning, he mastered this teaching in 3 lessons. Then he tested Jesus' ability to tune in by giving him the greeting, Assalamu alaikum, to which Jesus responded, Wa alaikum salam. When the angel Jibril revealed the first revelation of the Holy Quran to Prophet Muhammad, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, he revealed it within a mathematical context in which letters, words, verses, and chapters are all mathematically coded. The Holy Quran was later arranged, also by revelation, in the chapter sequence that we read today. We will note that the angel Jibril also appeared to Mary in the 19th surah, which carries her name, in exactly 19 verses, 16 through 24, announcing the birth of Jesus and some words about his future work and mission, which comes all the way down to us today. Happiness, brothers and sisters, is the removal of stress. When we have the right understanding about ourselves and others and the world in which we live. If we look at paragraph 1, where the word stress is applied to our assignment, it may be neglect of duty or default in duty, which produces the stress-related ailments that we're suffering today because we do not have the right understanding of ourselves, nor our relationship to God, nor our relationship to others, and to our relationship to the rest of the world. As we stay fully committed and focused on our assignment and mission, given in the details of the 13 paragraphs and in the body of our lessons, we will learn how to live happy and productive lives. And everything we touch will literally turn into gold. We are guaranteed that the restrictive law, when enforced, is our success. I have correlated the 10th system, the brain, to the Supreme Wisdom lessons, beginning with 10 questions and answers of student enrollment, which introduces us to the knowledge of God and the knowledge of self, from the very first question and answer, who is the original man? This means that God himself is the brain of all operations that make all the other 9 systems of the body work effectively. The first mention of the word brain appears in lesson number 2, question and answer 28, with a reference to Yaqub's grafting of the white race. The nurse stuck a needle in the brain of the black baby at birth, putting him to sleep, which is the condition of the black man and people today and all over the planet Earth. There is a parable in the Bible given in John chapter 21, verses 1 through 14, concerning Jesus' disciples who are being taught a lesson by Jesus on how to be fishers of men. They were throwing their nets rather haphazardly into the water from the boat, trying to catch fish. Jesus instructed them from the seashore to cast their nets on the right side of the boat. When following these instructions, they caught 153 fish and brought them to shore. It is interesting to note that if we take the 153 fish and add Jesus himself, the sum is 154, which is exactly equal to the number of questions and answers in our lessons. And I'm footnoting here for us to look at paragraph 3 of instructions for further details from our Savior Allah. But just in general, it states that the use of these lessons given to us to study by Master Farrar Muhammad must be used at all time with the new converts. It is the bait by which we will catch the fish. And we must prove at all times that our Savior Allah has come to deliver us, the end of this present civilization and the beginning of a new civilization which will be ruled by people who will uphold justice, freedom, and equality and will be made the new rulers of an entire new world civilization. This parable may be compared to the catching and processing of the new converts to Islam who are being raised from the dead. The means and methods in raising the dead have varied throughout the years, but the foundation of our recruiting effort is found in the use, practice, an application of the language in the proper terms with the use of the lessons of the supreme wisdom which must be used in the resurrection of the mentally dead. These lessons are designed and patterned from the mind and thinking of God, transmitted to his chosen servants, the prophets, as a guide for others. In the ancient land of our fathers, in Egypt, there stands in the middle and on the border thereof the great pyramid of Giza that remains to this day as the only remaining seventh wonder of the world. It was constructed on 13 acres of land, a few miles outside of Cairo. Its original casing stones, which was made out of pure white limestone, are equal to 22 acres. Every measurement was built and designed by the architect to measure in stone a history of the world of the last 6,000 years and beyond into the seventh millennium. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad first drew my attention to the study of the Great Pyramid and its mathematical measurements when he stated to some of his followers and family members at the dinner table that if we wanted to get a picture of how our ancient civilizations were built, that we should study the monuments in Egypt. The number of fish, 153, mentioned in John chapter 21, is also contained within the measurements of the Great Pyramid. As one enters on the north side of the Great Pyramid on the 19th core stone, you have to move left 286.1 pyramid inches. This number of pyramid inches appears in many places in the measurements of the stones and the inner passages that leads upwards to the truncated platform where there is a missing capstone. This number of pyramid inches, 286.1, is called the displacement factor. In order to correct this movement to the left, which implies deviation or sinister in Latin, one must turn to the right, counting that same measurement of pyramid inches to get back on track. This leads the initiate or student to higher wisdom on the path to becoming a master. It is interesting to note that the second chapter of the Holy Quran, entitled Al-Baqarah, the cow, contains exactly 286 verses and speaks of the deviation of the followers of Moses. Inside the Great Pyramid, there are ascending and descending passageways, which are measured according to the alignment of specific stars. This knowledge was given to us also from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. He stated that the pyramid was built in alignment to the stars, and that in order to destroy the pyramid and its meaning and its sign, you would have to destroy the stars to which they are aligned. He also taught us that the building of the pyramid was done by a mechanical mean of a hydraulic water to push the stones into place, and that at this particular time, that instrument has been hidden lest our open enemies discover its use and be able to prolong and extend their civilization. When we pass through the Grand Gallery that is constructed with seven tiers inside of the pyramid, we have an uplift that raises up beyond the stooped position that we're in when we reach those ascending or descending passageways. We come exactly 286.1 pyramid inches up so that we can really start taking a breath and keep moving in the direction of the truncated pyramid. We come then to a horizontal passage that leads to the king's chamber, located on the 50th, counting from the foundation up, to the 50th core stone. From the 50th core stone to the pyramid's platform, we measure another 153 core stones. Pay attention to the word course, because this is going to come up later as we move into the second part of my presentation, the word course and courses. We will note the recurrence of this number 153, which referred to the number of fish that were caught by seven disciples in the parable of Jesus and the fishermen. Now let us suppose that the missing capstone represents Christ himself. It is believed that the construction of the capstone was never done, though there are some who believe that it was originally made out of gold, and some believe that it was originally made out of crystal, that it was never really made at all. It was left there and designed by the architect to represent the Christ in the millennial age. And it was also there to represent a people who had been rejected, like the rejected stone that we read of in scriptures. So if then we say that this capstone represents Christ in his glory, and we add together the 153 core stones that led from the king's chamber to that truncated pyramid, we come exactly to the lesson code again, 154. When 154 is divided by 7, we get 22.7, which represents the fraction of pi. And among our ancient people of Egypt, they use fractions and not decimals. So you can read it as a decimal, 3.14 they generally give, or 3.1459. And we know it goes on into infinity, and they can't find the end of it. They cannot round that off. But let us see later what we can do with a fraction. As we review our entrance into the pyramid, we will recall that it was on the 19th core stone, which answers to the mathematical code of the Holy Quran. And we also found that the second chapter, the very second chapter, Baqarah, the longest chapter in the Holy Quran, contains exactly 286 verses, which represents the deviation and also the correction to get back on track. The Bible, too, in this specific instance, also answers to the mathematical code of 19. We read exactly in Isaiah 19, verses 19 and 20, a reference to the building of this monument, the Great Pyramid, standing in the middle of Egypt and on the border thereof. This hidden wisdom is contained in the use of letters and numbers and words that is a part of the Jewish numerical system called Gematria, or Gematria, I think it is Gematria, where letters, the Hebrew letters, were identified and used as numbers, which as a point of reference the rabbis concealed, which is called the Kabbalah and other Talmudic writings. But they knew the deeper secret meaning of these scriptural passages. And ultimately what happens is that as they added up the letters and the words that comprise the 19th verse of chapter 19 of Isaiah, it comes to 5,449. Now what is interesting is that is the exact height of the Great Pyramid that takes you to the truncated part, which means that there's something missing. Interesting, in the study of our lessons, in the student enrollment, we are given the birth or the birth date of Christianity, Buddhism, and Islam. Christianity is given as 551 years. So if you add that 551 years to the 5,449 figure, we get 6,000, which then lets us know that at the end of the 6,000 years that Christ will come, and he himself may represent then in this analogy the missing capstone and also the rejected stone that the builders disallowed until restored in the messianic age with the coming of the Messiah of Christ, who will establish the kingdom or his kingdom on earth with a people that is considered to be no people at all. This rejected stone becomes the chief cornerstone of the building and the foundation of God's new kingdom, referred to in the scriptures as the 7,000th millennium reign of Christ on earth. Could anything fit so perfectly? If we add together all those series of numbers that I identified as the displacement factor, that is 286.1 pyramid inches, that is counting 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 all the way up to 17, the result of those digits comes again, astoundingly, 153. Again, representing the number of fish caught by Jesus in the parable, revealing the number code of our lessons. The number 17 here, with six zeros added to it, comes to the figure 17 million, which represents the lost found members of the Nation of Islam in America when we were found by Master W. Farrard Muhammad. Every number, every letter, every word, every syllable has a profound connection to the mathematical theology of Islam, as we are taught in problem number 13. The Holy Quran reveals, and certainly we have made the word to have many connections for their sake, so that they may be mindful. Master Farrard Muhammad, God in person, laid the foundation of his new world order on a square number in mathematics, which is 12. When this number is squared, it gives us 144, which refers to the 144,000 elect. We will also see its reference to point number 12 in the Muslim program of wants and beliefs. Our lessons are mathematically coded for each student to enter the mathematical matrix of the Supreme Wisdom. The keys to the methodology and approach to our study is given by the Master himself in letters, numbers, words, and syllables, along with their pronunciation. So when you use this system, what happens is that you're able to look into everything around you, the atom itself, the physical world, the spiritual world, mental planes of consciousness, and you will begin to see that which others do not see. You will hear that which others do not hear, and you will perceive and see that which others are not perceiving and cannot see because they were not given this methodology, which was learned by the Jews and also has determined why they are the rulers of the present world order, how they happen to rule over their brothers of the Caucasian race. In the Supreme Wisdom Lessons, published recently in book form, we are given 13 paragraphs of instruction to study, followed by problem number 13. When these numbers are added together, the result is 26, which is equal to the 26 letters of the English alphabet, which is coded in the methodology of the 13th problem. And we have the 10 numbers. That is, when we recite 10 questions and answers of student enrollment, we have the 10 numbers of the mathematical language, which defines the deepest meaning of Islam. The basis of our work today, brothers and sisters, is to make our brains and our minds work in perfect alignment with the mind and thinking of God. The scientists come among us asking questions, helping us to tune into a higher frequency of thought and state of mental consciousness. As the Honorable Minister Farrakhan has entitled his 18th study guide, Rising Above Emotion into the Thinking of God. We, the Nation of Islam, lose no time. Ask questions and learn all about yourself. What are you doing today for yourself? Your brother from the East wants to know and hear from you at once. We find that written in one of our problems, problem number 31. Okay? I have attempted to demonstrate that the 10th system, the brain, represents the working of the mind of God through the example of the body of wisdom that he brought to us called the Supreme Wisdom teachings now of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. The Supreme Wisdom Lessons is like the illuminating book of the divine scriptures of both Holy Quran and Bible. The Great Pyramid of Egypt serves as a testimony in stone of this great truth. As we begin our courses of study in developing a national curriculum for all members of the Nation of Islam, we are all working from the same foundation of truth, hopefully to be approved by God. Now, brothers and sisters, I read to you exactly what I presented to the Honorable Minister Farrakhan. In the second part of my presentation, I am going to go further into the formula of pi and how it applies to the dynamics of our lessons and how it applies to the practical everyday life. And as I enter into this study, I want to utilize the vision of Ezekiel. And I will explain that when we get to the diagram. The discovery of pi in our lessons leads us to the entrance of the mathematical matrix of the supreme wisdom, lessons, and the theology of time computer game. The Honorable Minister Farrakhan has stated that whoever draws the diameter of your knowledge prescribes the circumference of your activity. Over the last several decades, I have attempted to apply the lesson's mathematical code to my everyday life's experiences. I was inspired to look more diligently into its application as a result of the words of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad directed to his laborers and family members at the dinner table in Chicago just prior to his departure. He also instructed me concerning the importance of the lessons in teaching others in Mexico. During these many years since his departure, I have attempted to find innovative ways to apply this wisdom that he shared with me. My first mathematical breakthrough came in the late 1970s and beginning years of the 1980s. I was introduced to both the mathematical 19-based revelation of the Holy Quran, and intuitively I came to see its relevance to the mathematical complement of 22.7 pi discovered in our lessons. As I previously stated, and I will repeat this, I divided the number 7 into 154, which resulted in 22, which combined together, 22.7, represents the fraction of pi. I applied the discovery of pi to the whole complex of the Muslim program presented by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, which I have configured in various diagrams, which includes reading assignments, books and study guide material, all programs for home study, and as a computer game for the entire family. I reviewed the 13 instructions to the laborers concerning the structure, the ideal structure of the ideal mosque, temple, school, educational center, and economic program, and discovered a whole system of reorientation linked to re-education and training, beginning from the grounds of Mosque Miriam, an educational center, to be disseminated throughout our communities, both at home and abroad. I discovered that in the working of these two main mathematical formulas, pi as a fraction, 22.7, and the 19 mathematical code of the Holy Quran, that I was able to synthesize the body of knowledge contained in the Supreme Wisdom lessons and the Muslim program in a mathematical way. The sign of Jesus' history and his mother are paramount to this study, especially in the area of Jesus' education and training, which took place in Egypt as a sign. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us that Jesus studied at Peach Pyramid, to which he also made a reference in the Theology of Time lecture series in 1972 to Al-Azhar University also as a sign. Many years ago, I had a dream in which I was visiting Cairo, Egypt. I was inside an apothecary and a fragrance shop. My eyes were attracted to a small glass beaker containing a container that held a liquid the color of amber. I asked the shopkeeper the name of the fragrance, and she told me that it was peach. When I awakened, I was puzzled over the meaning of that dream. Within several hours' time, I mentally turned the letters of the word peach around, scrambled them around, and it spelled Cheops. I then realized that Jesus' study at Peach Pyramid was a code for the master's training at the Great Pyramid of Cheops. The key to the mathematical matrix of the supreme wisdom lessons and the theology of time computer game that I am developing is based on the mathematical formula of pi. Our assignment of the supreme wisdom lessons is designed to teach a student how to tune in to the mind of God through a series of questions and answers, which was the way that the prophet or the wise man taught Jesus how to tune in by asking him a question, and he would then give the answers. We, brothers and sisters, are actually enrolled in the divinity school of God's, chosen and elected to be made the future rulers of a new world order born from a new world of thought. As we continue to process this information, we will become a light-bearing sun, reflecting Christ consciousness from within. By following this path of enlightenment, with further instructions from the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, we too will become a light unto the world. Thank you for your patience, submitted by a fellow student and follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Sister Tanetta Muhammad. Well, that ends, brothers and sisters, exact word per word, with a few commentaries that I made, presented to the Honorable Minister Farrakhan. And before I go into the second part of my presentation, which will show you one of the diagrams, I have many other diagrams, but since this is just the introduction, I have only one diagram that I am going to explain how the system works in the course of our re-education and training. I'm going to draw an analogy of my diagram presentation to the mechanics of the great mother wheel or plane, as we have been taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, who refers to the mechanics of the wheel, to Ezekiel's vision of a wheel in the middle of a wheel. The second reason for making this analogy of our supreme wisdom lessons to the great mother's wheel is to draw our attention to the vision-like experience of the Honorable Minister Farrakhan, who was taken to the wheel to be in direct communication with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, which took place in Mexico in 1985. There are various quotes from the messenger's writings on the mother wheel and Ezekiel that link directly to our studies. First of all, you will note that in our studies, particularly beginning with lesson number 2, which the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said symbolizes in those 40 questions and answers, the making of a man, the making of a very special man who is being prepared, all right, to be changed into a new people and to become the masters of a new world order that is to take the place of Satan's world. So the Savior is pointed out as being the Son of Man. The Son of Man. They looked for that mystery God for trillions and trillions of years. And they came to the conclusion that there is no mystery God, that He is the Son of Man. And we cannot point or to any other object of worship, a statue, fall down and worship, or any other means. Spirit cannot be God. The spirit itself has to be contained within a person, okay, who is highly evolved. So, a quote from Message to the Black Man in America, and you'll note Son of Man is mentioned at least 4-5 times in lesson number 2, and also the Son of Man and not a spook who measured all the planets and their distances and the speed of sound and the speed of thought is not done by a spook. They are actual facts done by W.D. Farrard or Master Farrard Muhammad. Now this is what he said on page 14 or page 17. He pointed out a dreadful looking plane that is made like a wheel in the sky today. It is a half mile by a half mile square. It is a humanly built planet. Listen to that. A humanly built planet. It is up there and can be seen twice a week. And he ends it by saying, it is no secret. Ezekiel saw it a long time ago. Then he continues, the sign of the Son of Man would be seen in the heavens. The tribes of the earth would mourn. They will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. That is from Matthew 24, 30. Now notice, Matthew starts with a sound, and we're going back and implementing why words and letters, etc., are taken apart, and you will begin to see the analogy, how it works. The first sound in Matthew is math. So mathematically and mechanically, we have the structure of the wheel, which is exact dimensions that are fulfilling a specific purpose. He goes on, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, to tell us that the vision of Ezekiel's wheel, in the sky, is true, if carefully understood. There is a similar wheel in the sky today, which very well answers the description of Ezekiel's vision. And he says, this wheel corresponds in a way with the sphere of spheres called the universe. The great wheel, which many of us see in the sky today, is not so much a wheel as one may think in such terms, but rather a place made like a wheel. The like of this wheel, like plane, was never seen before. The similar Ezekiel's wheel is a masterpiece of mechanics. His vision of the wheel included hints on the great wisdom of Almighty God Allah, that really he is the maker of the universe and reveals just where and how the decisive battle would take place in the sky. Ezekiel saw wheels in the middle of a wheel. This is true. The universe in the universe. These are the words from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. It is made up of revolving spheres. There are wheels in the wheel. The present wheel-shaped plane, known as the mother of planes, is 1/2 mile by 1/2 mile. That is 2,640 across and 2,640 square all around. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said in the lectures of the Theology of Time that it's 1 mile straight down to the center. So that means it's like a concave and oval-like, but it is awesome. And he said it was dreadful to look at. So it is the largest mechanical made object in the sky. It is a small human planet. He also stated that a whole new civilization is on that wheel. Now this is very fascinating. When I looked up Ezekiel as a result of making my diagram, I was very, very stunned to find that the very first chapter of Ezekiel, which describes how he was called by the river Shebar in the land of the Chaldeans or in ancient Babylon, no? That he saw like this light coming, so dazzling, like a whirlwind, it says, out of the north. And it was enfolding, it said, in light and in fire of the color of amber. And everyone knows that amber is a resin that is hardened and contains the colors of a yellow, orange tone. And we recently saw photos that were taken and videoed by a Mr. Diaz in Tepoztlan in Mexico at one of our conventions approximately a year or so ago. And he brought these dazzling photos that gave proof that the Honorable Minister Farrakhan truly had that experience on the wheel in the same place. This photographer, nearly in the same year, he photographed this particular object that had the color of amber. Now, the further description of Ezekiel goes on, and by the time you reach the 16th verse of the first chapter, Ezekiel says what he saw were these four living creatures. And they all had the appearance of a man. Now just pay attention to this. A man operating the wheel. Those that are with him are men. Though they're described with wings, up under their wings are hands. Isn't that something? And they have feet like, kind of like burning brass, it said. And then it says that above the firmament of this object, it was like the color of a terrible, these are the words from Ezekiel, verse 22, first chapter, a terrible crystal. So I wanted to know, what was this terrible crystal? And it gives a reference later down on the 26th verse, and it indicates that when you looked up above the firmament, which was this terrible crystal, there was a throne. And on the throne was the appearance of a man. That is why Ezekiel's vision is absolutely tantamount to being able to describe the phenomenon of the mother's plane, because Master Farhad Muhammad's first and greatest sign when he appeared in 1930 was to point out this miraculous plane, which is the mother's wheel, and the rest of the information that has been shared with us about what is on that wheel. And imagine, the Honorable Minister Farrakhan had an opportunity to be taken by a little wheel into the main mother's wheel to have the experience of communicating directly with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, so that there would be no doubt in our minds that this is real, that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad lives and he's on another plane of existence, mentally, physically, and spiritually. Now, the commission was appointed, and look at how interesting this was. I stated that the last 28 years, I have been studying how to present my study and my research, inspired from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's words, how I would have an opportunity to present that. And it has been exactly 28 years to this year since the departure of the messenger. And now, on top of it, the first chapter of Ezekiel, which describes this phenomenon, 28 verses of chapter 1. The very next chapter, chapter 2, it says Ezekiel commissioned. It uses the word commissioned. And it has exactly 10 verses. And that, to me, is comparable to what the Honorable Minister Farrakhan, son of man, another son of man, he says, go to the rebellious house of Israel. They are stiff-headed and rebellious. And he said, and don't pay attention to their mean faces and their harsh words. You go and you teach them. Anyway, I am with you. I am there to back you up. Look at that. And then he commissions, it says Ezekiel commissioned, and he commissioned the 9 commissions. And now with the 10th commission, the brain occupies exactly the number of verses that you read when Ezekiel is commissioned in the second chapter. The next most important part, I mentioned earlier that there are 40 questions and answers to lesson number 2. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that that was guiding us to the making of a man, a new man, the son of man. And that's where the son of man appears. There are exactly 40 chapters to the beginning of the construction, reconstitution, reorganization of the temple that would be set up in the millennium age. And that then brings the number of chapters of Ezekiel to 48. I am telling you, brothers and sisters, from my own experience, every single day, every morning when I rise up for prayer and study my Quran and study the lessons and study the Bible or points of references that may come to me, that I'm continually receiving new and information that is so powerful that I can hardly write it down, I can hardly retain it in my mind. But I want that same spirit to come to you and be inspired with the same assignment. I'm not studying anything any different from any one of you, any one of us. So I wanted to point that out because I think that that's very, very significant. The next aspect of my presentation has to do with a diagram and how this wheel in a wheel concept came to me. Now I've quoted what the Honorable Elijah Muhammad has said. So I'm going to take my pointer, and I also have a marker board here, so that may Allah guide me to present this next portion of my presentation in a way that you will have understanding. We're now going to focus on this diagram. At the top, a wheel within a wheel. So with my previous explanation, you can now connect to Ezekiel, the messenger's words, and the minister's vision. It says the Supreme Wisdom Lessons, Diagram 1. This is the way we start. In the center of this wheel of color, representing the seven colors of the rainbow, and the seven colors of the rainbow are mentioned as a bow that was seen above the sapphire throne in Ezekiel in 26. And there was also the bow that comes after the rain, so it's like the rainbow. So we know the refraction of light through a prism will give us these seven colors of the rainbow. Now the center represents the universe. And recall that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad stated in the book, Message to the Black Man, that the creation of this wheel was made like a universe in a universe, and it's constantly pulling up things into our view. So we have the flag of Islam, which is the universal flag. We have the crescent moon in its first quarter. We have the five-pointed star against a red sun background. Now, if you look closely at this flag, you will see that the star has 5 points, and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that that represents our five senses. Now I'm going to take us a little bit deeper into what I think we can understand from this. These 2 points dissect the circle so that we count 5, 6, 7. 7 points in this center of the sun. Now, around this are seven colors of the rainbow radiating out. Now, before I go on to the explanation of what those seven colors represent, look down here. 6 sets of lessons equals 154 questions and answers divided by 7 equals 227 formula for pi. Now, you know, if you multiply 22 by 7, you can come back to the whole figure of 154. So the perfection of the zero, or the perfection of the move into a full circle, is only arrived then if we use a fraction and not if we use the decimal. Okay? So the 53 is incomplete without adding the God himself. So he is like the one in front and guiding. So this supreme wisdom comes like that to us. It is a circle within a circle of the sphere of his wisdom. He initiated himself in the beginning. And how did he do that? And this is where I wish for your attention to see if you understand this. Where did pi originate from? As you know, the universe is the spirals, circles upon circles, the universe within universe, spheres within spheres, as the Honorable Elijah Muhammad pointed out. God began in the making of himself in darkness, a light of himself. But the Honorable Elijah Muhammad pointed out in the theology of time that he first had to draw a diameter of himself. Then after he drew the diameter, then he made a sphere or a circle to encompass that which his brains conceived within that circle of knowledge that he himself was creating. Now, he said, nobody, nothing can come into existence unless it comes out of that circle or body of wisdom of the God's first creation of himself. So, therefore, I use this sphere, this sphere, this circle, and it will enlarge in the next diagrams, and more material will be added to the colors of the rainbow that you see here. So if pi itself originates with God, then pi is the perfect mathematical equation to prove that our lessons that were designed and given to us by God is the continuation of wisdom, of worlds out of worlds, of a new world of thought into the building of a new kingdom based upon the principles of mathematics, so that mathematics is Islam, Islam is mathematics, it is eternal, it is infinite, it goes on and on and on. And the scientists could not see an end to his wisdom. They all had to fall down, the 24 scientists, because they could not see an end to the great wisdom of Master Farhad Muhammad. Now, another example I'm going to give you here is that this color wheel is the main diagram that opens up to the rest that will be shared with you perhaps in another tape. If the five-pointed star represents our senses, we also can derive our Islamic studies. How is that? We have five pillars of Islam. We have the five theoretical beliefs and the five practices of Islam. We have our five daily prayers, to which we add, if you take these 2 points, two more prayers, which really brings the number to seven. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that when you rise in the night, you should recite another prayer, or even another prayer in the nighttime, added to your five daily prayers, that would bring the number to seven. Another very fascinating thing is that we can find the flag of Islam, the flag of Islam, in the Bismillah, the opening Bismillah and the Bismillah statement over 113 surahs. And one would say, how do you do that? Well, I'm going to go to the chalkboard. When we say Bismillah, Bismillah, okay, not too good, but Bismillah, equals seven letters. Okay, then in the next part of the statement, it's Rahman, equals six letters. And Rahim equals six letters. Okay, that is the opening Bismillah in Al-Fatiha, and it's over all of the surahs as we know, except Surah 9. What do you see as you look at these numbers? Do you see any relativity to the histories that we are taught about the sun, the moon, and its separation from the earth? All right. It is this way. 7, 6. All right. 76 trillion, 76T, 76 trillion years ago, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us that the sun came into its present existence in our solar system. So we have 76 trillion years ago for the sun. And then I'm surrounding 66. Okay, we know what happened 66 trillion years ago. That was the moon explosion. Now we can do something more with these numbers, because we have its relevance to the earth, the planet. And by the way, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad answers the question and ends in lesson number one, question and answer nine, which one and nine is a 19 again. But if you put that together, he says that the sun, the moon, and the star are planets. That's the original form that they are coming out of planets. And now we can see, because the moon was once a part of the earth. Now, how do we get earth out of this? Take these two numbers, 6, 6. 6 plus 6 equals 12. The moon dropped or went up 12,000 miles high. If we multiply 6 times 6, we get 36. And 36 was the amount dropped of the earth when she separated from the moon 36,000 miles. So in the Bismillah, and this is the beauty of the methodology that we were taught, you can take letters, numbers, words, you can combine them in all kinds of ways, and you will get a deep root underlying teaching other than what you're seeing on the surface. So you can go as deep, deep, deep as you can go. Mathematics is the key. It's interesting, I just happened to see this. If 6 and 8 and 3 and 4, 48, okay, that represents something else, but in application to what we've been studying about a wheel and a wheel, we pointed out that Ezekiel makes up 48 chapters, which goes into the make of this wheel that has never been made before. And God then is identified as being seen in the clouds, and that the hearts of people will be, you know, perplexed, and all kinds of disasters will befall the planet when they look up and see the Son of Man coming down from the heavens. Now, going back, I wanted to show you. So we have the flag of Islam, number per number, sun, moon, and the earth, and its declination to 36,000 miles out of its original pocket. Now we will go back. I'll leave that there for a moment. Now let us go back here. Out of the sphere or circle, in the circle, our national flag, the universe, Islamic studies base can come out of this, the Holy Quran's mathematical code of 19. What I did was take the 7 colors of the rainbow and make in each one of these quadrants, entering into the circle sphere here, and you will put in, it's not marked here, 22 sections of the lesson. So that every day, and this is the reading program that I will recommend, it's very easy, 22 and color tab each day. You can choose the colors that you wish to represent, but each day choose a color tab that, and in that period of time, every member of the family will read 22 parts of the lessons. You just read it, 22 from student enrollment, and then you'll go over and you'll hit 22 somewhere in the actual facts. And then you go down from actual facts, you will count another 22, and that will take you into lesson number 1. Then the next sequential lesson is lesson number 2, then the 34 problems, and English lesson number C1. When you separate and find the 22, 7 times in the lessons, you will read in 1 week 22 parts of the lesson per day, until you just read them through once a week. You can repeat that. Pretty soon, you will have memorized by heart without, you know, too much difficulty, and you just read them. You don't have to stop and just keep reciting it over and over. It all depends on you. But at least minimal requirement is to read 22 parts of the lesson each day, and each day will correspond to a different color. Now, in the 13 instructions, to get familiar with them and read, you would expand your 7 days reading assignment by reading 2 paragraphs of the 13 instructions per day. As you read these 2 on Sunday, or the last day, it will be 1, which is the 13th paragraph. Now I will erase this. I think I have just about completed the explanation here that I wanted to, except I'm going to say that is amazing. There is a book called The Temple in Man. Some of you, you know, may have access to it, but in that book, it tells you through a scholar, Leibniz from France, who studied many, many years at the Temple of Luxor. And remember, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, study the monuments in Egypt. Well, he made a very lengthy study of the Luxor Temple and the reliefs, so the way that the pharaohs were etched and carved you know, into the wall, temple walls. And it was exactly the ancient Egyptians who utilized these two principal formulas that I pointed out today, the number 19 and 22-7 as a fraction. And they did what you call quadratures. And in these quadratures, they measured the pharaoh's head all the way down to his feet. And they utilized either or, 19 quadratures or the pi fraction of 22-7. So we'll talk more on that later. But what I wanted to put up on the board now goes back to the beginning of the August 23rd and the presentation made by the chairperson, Dr. Abdul Alim. And what he put on the screen was fascinating. It kept flashing. Whoops, are we going to see this? Okay. Atonement. Okay, atonement and then commission. And by using this methodology, I kept looking, looking, and I said, oh, wow. I said, atonement has 9 letters, and commission has 10 letters. And of course, adding them together, you have 19. And I said, my goodness, everything is absolutely coded. I mean, we can't get away from it. Whatever we do, there is a coded language that is embedded in the presentation itself. And in the word commission, if you break it up, it says come to the mission. So we are being asked by God, through his representative, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, to come to the mission. What is the mission? It is the resurrection of our mentally dead people. To come to the mission, how? Through atonement, which is an atone, which can be then mathematically and musically scaled. Because beneath all of this, we have diagrams that shall show you that underlying the codes is a musical scale of sound. But atonement, to be at one with whom? With God first, and with yourself, and then with those around you. So now, look at what else you can do. This is with our children too. It makes it like games to play, but very interesting. Come, I, mit, take your word up here, commit, mint. Interesting. So we want to come to the mission to be committed to the service, of Almighty God, Allah, through the working out of self, and then everything else will fall into place. Okay, so there's your 19. So the signature of God is on the commission. Now the next and final part of my presentation today will go this way. He also put on the board, in the very beginning, Dr. Alim, he pointed out that the organization of the committee, okay, for 1776 Constitution and the July 4th Declaration of Independence from 1776. Now, this is a very interesting discovery. The Savior came 1930, and he brought with him the code in himself, and he had already prepared a body of knowledge and wisdom to share. If you take the lessons, 1, 5, 4, the code of the lessons, and you add it to 1776, you will get the year, exactly 1930, when Master Farrakhan Muhammad came. So I'm going to leave you shortly with this thought and with these words. If this presentation has had some meaning for you to see the beauty and the wisdom that we were given in the supreme wisdom lessons of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and to be back on track again and follow the guidelines and instructions of the Honorable Minister Farrakhan, I hope that this has helped to widen your comprehension and understanding of the value of this most beautiful assignment and opportunity that we have to move from the left 286.1 pyramid inches to go right 286.1 pyramid inches, which takes us into all of the beautiful studies of the Holy Quran itself. As I entered into this day, which is August 28th, I opened the Quran for guidance. And I marked the place, and it takes us right back to the Honorable Minister Farrakhan's instructions to us recently on that day, August 23rd, about the importance of prayer. And I opened to Surah 17, Section 9, and it says, truth will prevail. And the focus is on prayer. And the focus is on being truthful. And I would like to close in my presentation today by reading that section, beginning with verse 78. Keep up prayer from the declining of the sun till the darkness of the night, and the recital of the Quran at dawn. Surely the recital of the Quran at dawn is witnessed. And during a part of the night, keep awake by it beyond what is incumbent on thee. Maybe thy Lord will raise thee to a position of great glory. And say, my Lord, make me enter a truthful entering, and make me go forth a truthful going forth, and grant me from thy presence an authority to help me. And say, the truth has come, and falsehood vanished. Surely falsehood is ever bound to vanish. And we reveal of the Quran that which is a healing and a mercy to the believers. And it adds only to the perdition of the wrongdoers. And when we bestow favors on man, he turns away and behaves proudly. And when evil afflicts him, he is in despair. Say, everyone acts according to his manner. But your Lord best knows who is best guided on the path. I thank you for your attention as I leave you the greetings of peace and paradise and prayers for our success to be accepted by God. Assalamu alaikum.